the Garda, who in her talk today gave her usual impassioned speech on the necessity and the advocacy of climate change, which she has championed and is a recognized champion, not only in the Senate, but I guess in the entire country. But when I was listening to her narrative on the measures that she had taken in her own life, in her own household, I suppose following the adage, think global, act local, I was struck by an observation, and I'm sure Secretary Sani Alvarez would agree with me here, that when I was listening to her, yes, this is following the mantra of reduce, reuse, and recycle. But then when I was listening to the specific examples that she gave, and again, the Secretary Alvarez, again, I'm sure find the same observation, I said, this just sounds like being Ilocano. So ngayon, Secretary, hindi na tayo puripot. Tayo ngayon ay green. I would like to, of course, greet Secretary Sani Alvarez, USEC Maria Catalina Cabral, ASEC Gilbert Reyes, the engineer Dani Porcelan, the chairman of the Philippine Green Building, and the country director for the Philippines of the World Bank, Motuo Kunishi. Ladies and gentlemen, maganda pong umaga sa inyong lahat. I extend my sincerest and proudest congratulations to the Department of Public Works and Highways on the much-awaited launching of the maiden set of our National Green Building Regulation, painstakingly collated and proposed in one Philippine Green Building Code. Much credit is, of course, due to the professionals in the industry, the stakeholders, the partners, and the active local governments who have all contributed their valuable time, talent, and insights in accomplishing this rather intricate and important task. We hail this as a triumph of mutual collaboration between government and the private sector, led, of course, by a proactive and visionary department led by its forward-looking and committed secretary. This code is clear proof that our DPWH has chosen to rethink and reverse our nationally ingrained, wasteful, and imprudent building practices and the so-called business-as-usual paradigm, and heed the worldwide call for a more environmentally conscious building method and practice. In doing so, it has stamped its mark on this very important part of our national contribution to the world's climate change mitigation strategies. And the DPWH family must be proud of its contribution, having been able to assemble and unite, collect, and distill the combined wisdom and best practices of great minds in government, in the building industry, pioneering local governments such as the cities of Mandaluyong, Makati, and Quezon City, and other important stakeholders. The result is a practical and hopefully equally effective means of achieving a desirable and workable green building framework for initial implementation in the entire country, especially when we think of the rather long and tedious alternative, the process of lawmaking in Congress. Ano nga ba naman ang alam ng karamihan ng miyembro ng Kongreso upos sa mahirap at napakasalimot na teknikal na aspeto ng green building? Sa financial na aspeto o larangan ng budget ng DPWH, siguro kaya pa namin. Ngunit, pagdating sa agham at siyensya, babalik pa rin ang Kongreso sa ating mga magagaling na mga kinatawan ng kakawaran at sa mga kasamang mga dalubhasa at espesyalista sa industriya. Besides, the department not only has a clear mandate under our National Building Code to safeguard life, health, property, and public welfare consistent with the principles of sound environmental management and control, but also possesses the technical competence to authoritatively institute effective, viable, affordable, and flexible and responsive green building practices for our communities to adopt and to follow. With a favorable DOJ opinion, confirming the department's mandate, and also a formidable team of experts and professionals in support, the code becomes an arguably unassailable law, not only in its legal authority, but also in its preferred technical analyses and conclusions. However, we take note that the code is as yet untested in its implementation and its enforcement. As the saying goes, the proof of the pudding is in the eating. So therefore, there is still much to be done. Even after launching this code, we still have to go back to study and diagnose the overall regulatory framework that will actually take care of the proper and faithful implementation of the Green Building Code. And this is where the best and actual practices of our model LGUs, the cities of Mandaluyong, Makati, and Quezon City, will become most useful. Let us not forget, the success of the implementation of this regulation boils down to a local government concern, or to put it in the negative, a local government problem. Which is why, when we heard my green building bill in the Senate, the discussions unavoidably branched out and led us to parallel discussions of the need to strengthen the regulatory framework at the LGU level. Through the creation of the separate office of the building official in cities and certain municipalities, specifically municipalities which are classified as first or second class municipality. The reason for this is simply the financial capability of those local governments. The cities clearly have the capability to create the office of the building officer, first and second class municipalities are the same. However, those of lower classification seem to be struggling with being able to fund them. And that is where I think we really need to put in some important work. And that is to somehow, not only financially, but in terms of technical know-how, in terms of capability, in terms of experience, in terms of training, we really have to help the local governments who recognize very well, because whatever we say, those our communities around the country, which are not urban communities, which are rural communities, live closer to the land than we do here in the cities. Although we understand in an intellectual level what the problems are when it comes to climate change, when it comes to disaster preparedness and mitigation, they live it. And of course, it is something that they depend upon for their livelihood every single day of their lives. This is how they feed their families. This is how they send their children to school. This is how they house and clothe those that their loved ones. So the desire to be part of this movement, it exists. It is up to us in government to give them the ability, give them the skills, give them the experience and the backing and the support so that they can actually carry out what comes naturally to those who live this close to the problems that we are trying to mitigate. Of course, the LGUs of Mandaluyong, Makati, and Quezon City are on a different level. They are a step ahead, and I would say a cut above the rest in this regard. They have taken the cudgels by creating the OBO, or the Office of the Building Official, through the passage of a local ordinance without waiting for it to be mandated in any national law. It is believed that the institutionalization of the building official is essential to capacitate our local governments to cope with the increasing demands and pressures of their routine and round-the-clock task of ensuring safety and resiliency of our buildings, especially in light of important public concerns such as climate change mitigation and disaster risk reduction. It is hoped that this necessary structural change will unburden and unload local engineers who generally have to double as building officials by mandating that another professional devotes exclusive attention to the equally important task of strict enforcement of our national building code, including, of course, our green building referral code. I was quickly chatting with Yusek Kaplan about this particular subject just as we were working. And it is unfortunate, and in her description, that the consequences of our political system, of our electoral system, is such that the DPWH goes out and conducts these trainings, and as she was pointing out, that it is very that they are very enthusiastic and they are very knowledgeable, but 3 years later they are changed, and we have to conduct this training again, and there is a lack of consistency in our efforts. This is something that we really have to remedy, and it is something that we have to recognize as the principle at the very beginning that surely climate change, disaster mitigation and preparedness, all the green issues that we are facing and are becoming more and more urgent, surely they are way beyond importance than local politics or any politics that for that matter. But as with many serious endeavors, there will surely be birth pains. As the department has been strong-willed and effective in the conceptualization and drafting of the code, I urge and rally the department to be ever more strong-willed and effective as it confronts and braves the initial apprehensions, criticisms, and indifference of a surprised, though hopefully small, portion of the public, who are as yet unacquainted and unaware of this emerging paradigm and booming industry of green building. Slowly but surely, the public will soon realize the importance of green building to our lives as a people, to our community, and most of all, to the environment. More especially, if it carries the promise of economic development for our country, particularly when the so-called green economy is open, and its economic potential tap, which would help create investments, jobs, and economic value for our people in the process. So, I bid you a productive exchange of information and insights in this forum. Hopefully, you will care to put more emphasis on the workability of the enforcement and monitoring on the ground. So this early you can already diagnose, foresee, and remedy the problems that would be encountered along the way. The model LGUs are there. Let us continue to seek and give credence to their practical insights and frontline knowledge. Let us continue to learn from the experience not only of our model LGUs, but from all the LGUs, as they are all valuable. Let us recognize that there are individual differences from different parts of the country, and let us have a measured response to that difference. The LGUs are indeed essential and indispensable partners in this Herculean task. If we want to achieve a surefire and sustained success nationwide and at the soonest possible time, they have to be made capable. As a final word, I encourage the department to collate and condense the significant findings and observations made here and thereafter, suggest to Congress what are the needed adjustments and refinements to our legislation and government institutions and structure, so as to ensure that the Green Building Code would evolve to a more effective and workable mechanism. Through the help of its champions of the environment, Congress will be able to respond quickly and with a sense of urgency, as these efforts will ultimately impact our continued survival as a people and as a nation. Again, congratulations to the Department of Public Works and Highways and the entire green building industry and all its advocates and supporters. Here's to more resource-efficient, environmentally friendly buildings, healthier, more livable, and more resilient communities, and a more prosperous country brought about by the promise of a green economy. Maraming salamat po.